So good morning everyone, and welcome to this session of Selenium Conference 2020. So today's my topic, it's the rise of Shadow DOM, and let's solve it through by using two different approaches. First is WebDriver Selenium, we can say, and second it's WebDriver IO. It's a wrapper over WebDriver itself. So without wasting time, let's move ahead. So before starting this session, let me introduce my company where I'm currently associated. So currently I am working with 3Pillar Global. It's a service-based company. So we are implementing products for our clients, and so that they can enhance their revenues and they can grow in this competitive market. So in short, we can say we are a product lifecycle management and a software product development company. And this company is founded in 2006, and we have four global centers. It's in India, one it's in Costa Rica, one it's in Romania, and the headquarters in USA, Fairfax. In my company, we are implementing different products by using latest technologies. We are implementing web-based applications. We are implementing native mobile applications like iOS, Android, and some hybrid by using React Native. And we also giving cloud services to our clients. And last but not least, we also giving queue automation services by using different open source tools. Okay, so 3Pillar Global has been recognized as a Great Place to Work certified organization in India. So this is for its outstanding company culture for its second straight year. And this prestigious certification from the Great Place to Work Institute is awarded to those companies that foster excellent workplace environments for their employees. So we are lucky. We have good culture in my company. And let me introduce myself. My name is Virendra Singh. Professionally, I have a good experience in area of QA automation, and currently I'm associated as a senior QA automation lead with 3Pillar Global. And as my company following agile culture, so this culture always motivates me to explore new technologies, new tools, and which is coming new to the market. And being a leader, like I'm working as a senior QA automation lead, so leadership always push me to help my juniors, to help my peers. So within the project, or whether it is within the company, or whether it is outside of the company, through the social networking and etc. I am always open to help anyone in my field. And apart from this professional things, I am also a triathlete, and currently preparing for Ironman 70.3 miles competition, which will be held in next year now. And these are my contact details. If anybody wants to reach out to me, then can email me at virender.pannu@gmail.com, or can approach me through the LinkedIn. Okay. So today's agenda, I'll be covering three main topics there. First topic, it's web components and custom elements with Shadow DOM. So this is the one thing. The second thing, then we'll solve it by using WebDriver. And the third thing, we'll solve the same Shadow DOM by using WebDriver IO. Okay, so let's have brief idea about it, but what we are going to discuss today. So first of all, we'll talk about web components, then custom elements, and the Shadow DOM, and how this Shadow DOM is different from the light DOM. We'll discuss more about it as well, and how it creates problems for the automation guys. We'll see all these things as well. So basically, all these things are new age HTML, which is creating problems for QA automation guys. We'll solve it through by using two different approaches. So first approach, it's like we usually encountered problems because of this Shadow DOM. So suppose we are WebDriver guys and we face problems because of the Shadow DOM, then how WebDriver interact with this Shadow DOM? And we would have a demo at the end. And second approach, it's like the problems encountered to the WebDriver IO guys, those are working on this tool. And then we will see like how this WebDriver IO tools natively support how to handle this Shadow DOM. Then we will see the demo about it. Okay, so moving ahead. Before moving ahead, let me tell you the problem statement which I encountered a few months or around 1 year back. Like I was sitting in my company on someday, and one of my colleague came to me, like he has to prepare some POC on his new application. Actually, he was even not able to interact with the elements by using our simple selector approaches like XPaths or CSS selectors. He was not able to find those elements. It's a weird situation for him because if one of us is not able to find out the elements itself, then it's a shame for us. So I was quite busy at that time, but I asked him to provide me their application URL so that I can look at it when I will get some time. So when I came back to home, then I looked at that URL and I also tried to find out those elements by using same simple approaches like XPath and CSS selectors. Even I tried JavaScript, but I was not able to find those elements. Then finally, what I have seen on the web developer tools, like there is one thing which is written like shadow root. Then I Googled that term and then I came across like, oh, so this is the Shadow DOM and we cannot interact directly Shadow DOM elements by using these simple selectors. We have to take a different approach for it. Okay. So this is the problem statement which I encountered before moving ahead. First of all, we need to discuss about the web components. So what are the web components? So whenever any application renders on a browser, then it always contains three things. First thing, it contains HTML. So this is the structure of the elements. Second thing, it always contains CSS, like styling of those elements. Third thing, it always contains the JavaScript, like through JavaScript, we can take actions on those elements. So we always see these three things in our web browser through the web developer tools. As we know, like DOM is, it's a very known term to each and everyone. Like it's a structured representation of an HTML document, and through JavaScript, we can interact with those elements and we can manipulate those elements within the DOM because JavaScript has a complete access of the DOM. Okay, let's talk about web components now. Web components are basically, it's a W3C standard feature that is being incorporated in HTML5. It's because it's a new age HTML. It's also in the Google's Polymer library. It's also in the Google's Lit Element library. And there are some more libraries in the market where we can see these web components. Web components are a set of APIs that facilitate the creation of new custom reusable HTML elements. Like we can see here, reusable HTML elements. We can see header. We have used header twice. We have here and we have header here. We have footer here, we have footer here. And that can be used in web pages and web apps with your functionality. And that is isolated from the rest of your application code. We can see here. So these are completely modular and reusable components we can see on this web application, or we can say web page. Basically, this web page, it's divided into different web components, or we can say different smaller modules, we can say. And these modules, these modular components are reusable across the web application. And this web component has four different building blocks we can see here. One is the custom HTML elements. Second is the shadow DOM. Third is the HTML templates. And fourth one is the HTML imports. But in this session, we'll only talk about these two building blocks because we need those. We don't need these two. So we'll talk about the custom HTML elements. We'll talk about the shadow DOM. Okay. So here we can see these web components can interact with each other very easily, but they cannot access each other's properties. For example, one web component has one property, and let's say color is red, and another web component has a different color, maybe the color is green. Then they can interact with each other if they require it, but they cannot impact each other's properties, right? Here is one hack. For example, if we have any global properties on that application, let's say its color is black, so in that case that property would be applicable to each and every web component in that application because it's a global property, and as well as it's an inheritable property. We have non-inheritable properties also, like background color. It's a non-inheritable property, but if you make it global, then it won't impact any of the web component. Okay, let's say color is a global property, but we can override this property within the web component. For example, in header itself, if we override that property, then we can change it. We can override it in any web component. It's all up to you. Okay, moving ahead. So let's talk about the custom elements. Custom elements are, here we can see, custom elements are like, these are very kind of HTML elements with custom templates, behaviors, and tag names made with set of JavaScript APIs. Here we can see we have used HTML element class to make those custom elements. Here we have inherited this, we have extended this HTML element class right there. And by using this class, we are creating a new custom elements by using this method. We can see here custom elements.define. We are defining this new tag, myElement. And before and just below that, we can see myElement is the HTML which will be rendered on the browser itself by using this code. We can see right there. Let me open one file there. Here we can see this page. What I have done here, it's the same code which I have mentioned in the slide itself. We can see my element right there, and under that custom element we have one button. If we try to access this by using XPath, then we can very easily find this button, right? And if we try to find by using CSS, maybe let me use CSS right there. Then again, we are able to find this button because still the shadow DOM is not applied on that code. It is just a custom elements which we can access by using any selector like XPath or like or CSS or by using the JavaScript. We can easily access those elements. Here we can see we haven't applied any shadow DOM right there, and that's why that's very easy for us to access those custom elements. Now let me apply shadow DOM on this. So here we can see the same code, the class extending again HTML element, and below that we can see the same custom element, but here in between this method we have a test shadow DOM. We can see right there, and we can see the mode is open. We'll talk about the mode as well down the line. So currently the mode is open, I mean the shadow DOM is openly applied on those custom elements, and here we can see the shadow is appended with that button as well. Okay, let me open this, let me go there right now. So this is the same code which I have mentioned in the slides. If we click on that element, then we can see under this custom element we have a shadow root now, and the mode is open for it. Now we can see the button is under the shadow root, it's a part of that shadow DOM. If we try to access this directly, then we cannot access it. Let me try to find out the X path first. We can see it is not visible, like we are not able to fetch this element by using XPath. Now let me try this CSS again. JavaScript. Let me try CSS as well. Like nothing is fetchable by using these simple selectors. So this is the problem. Like it's a super annoying for everyone. Like if we are not able to find the elements by using our different approaches, then it's a really a big problem for us. Now the question arises in mind that if the custom elements gets encapsulated after attaching shadow DOM, then how to interact with these custom elements inside the shadow DOM? So we have one thing, like as we have seen, query selector, it's an entry point for the whole DOM. I mean, I'm talking about the main DOM, which we usually see in the developer tools. So query selector, it's an API, it's an entry pointer for any DOM. Now, what is the entry pointer for the shadow DOM? So we have a shadow root API. This is the entry point. It's again an API. This is the entry point to enter into the shadow DOM. So we need a shadow root API with query selector method to fetch the elements. Although shadow DOM is a useful solution for web developers because there are some security issues, but it becomes a challenge for automating testing because those elements inside a shadow root technically do not exist in the main or the light document DOM. It's a problem for us. So let's try to fetch this element by using a shadow root. Here we can see the query selector, then the my element. This is the out of shadow DOM. And now we can see the button. This is inside the shadow DOM. So that's why we have used shadow root dot query selector. If you try to fetch this, then we can easily see it is visible to the user. We can find the elements very easily. So one thing, the mode is open currently. If I make the mode closed, let me make it closed. Here we can see the mode is open. If I'm making it closed. Yeah, I can hear you, Shweta. Just a moment, let me try this. I think I'm not able to move this thumbnail because no, I'm not able to track. Okay, thank you, Shweta. Okay, so now I made it closed. Now we can see the mode is closed, and let me open this element again. If I refresh it, and if I try to fetch this element by using this shadow root, then we are not able to interact or the fetch that element because closed mode means the shadow root is, in that case, shadow root is always null. I mean the element is not available to the user. So what is the use of open mode and the closed mode? So we can ask the developers, for example, they do this because of some security issues. They make it closed mode so that any person cannot interact with those elements. So in that case, what we can ask to the developer, suppose we have to automate those pages, in that case we can ask developers to make the mode is open on the sandbox, or the we can say on the test environment, but on the production environment they can make it closed mode. So in that case, like, security would be fixed by the developers, and also we can automate our scripts very easily. We can verify our regression suites on the sandbox itself or on the test environment itself. We can ask to the developers about this. Okay, if I make it open again, if I save it, if I refresh it, and if we try to fetch it once again, then it's visible to the user again, like we can interact with those elements. Okay, let me move to the next slide. Okay, so let's understand how Shadow DOM works within the browser. So here we can see at the top, it's a light or the main DOM, which we usually see. And there is a document interface that is the entry point for the light DOM or the main DOM. But within the main DOM, we can have any number of shadow DOM. So there is one entry point for any shadow DOM. It's a shadow host. So in our case, it's a, we can see here, just a moment. It's in our case, my element, it's a shadow host for us, because this is the entry point into the shadow. Okay, so here we'll talking about the shadow host. It's a kind of entry point into the any shadow DOM. And below that entry point, we can see any number of shadow roots. And we can have single level shadow roots. Here we can see it's a single level shadow root. And we can have multiple shadow roots as well. For example, in one shadow root, we can have another shadow root, and we can have multiple elements in another shadow roots. So here I would say again, like, Shadow DOM, it's a Shadow DOM is a kind of web standard that developers use to encapsulate their custom HTML code and style components and with JavaScript as well. And Shadow DOM elements are not visible to the documents.query selector API, because these are only visible to the shadow root, I mean the document.shadow root API. Okay, and here we can see the scoping, like we have boundary for these shadow root elements. So if we have to enter into this boundary, then we have to use shadow root API. Without this, we cannot enter into the boundary and we cannot interact with those elements. Let me open one application, just a moment. I have already opened, I think so, Todo app. Okay, so this application, it's implemented in the by using the Polymer library. It's a Google's library, and the earlier which we have seen, these are the HTML5 based app code which we have seen. So in this, here we can see the multiple level of shadow roots. Here we can see we have Todo app, it's an entry point, or we can say shadow host, and under that we can see one shadow root, then one element, another shadow root, then there are loads of elements. We can see the text area here, and if we try to fetch these elements, if I try to fetch these elements, it's a multi-level shadow roots. Just a moment, let me make it bigger. Here we can see one ID, then we have another ID. Shadow root query selector adds items, then shadow root query selector enter text area. We can see here it's a multi-level shadow roots. So this is what I have shown right there. Let me go to the next slide. So this is all about like which browsers are supporting this Shadow DOM. Here we can clearly see we have two versions of Shadow DOM. It's a version 0, which is already deprecated. Maybe it is used by some developers still on already implemented applications, but currently the developers using it's Shadow DOM version 1. And here we can see it's almost supports every browser. Like we can see Edge, the latest versions of Edge browser, the Firefox, we can see the Chrome, Safari, Opera, we can see Safari, iOS Safari as well. It's a partially support to this Shadow DOM, maybe not fully, but there are few which is not supporting. It's a Opera Mini, but it is supported by Android browsers, Opera Mobile, Chrome for Android, and we can see a list of browsers which is supported by this Shadow DOM. Like we can, in short, we can say Shadow DOM can be rendered on any kind of latest browsers. So that's why it's getting popular nowadays and developers using it. The two purposes, one is security and maybe second thing, it's supported by each kind of browsers nowadays. Let me go to the next slide. Okay, so it's time to talk about the WebDriver approach with the Shadow DOM. Okay, we can interact with the Shadow DOM by using JavaScript, which we have already seen, and then how the WebDriver can interact with those elements. The WebDriver can only interact with those elements by using JavaScript Executor API. We have to use this with the WebDriver, then only we can interact with those elements and we can take actions on those elements, because there is no native support by WebDriver itself, but we have workaround for it and we can very easily interact with web elements, Shadow DOM web elements. Let me show you one quick demo. Here I have written like very basic code about it. I have used this local application which is implemented in Polymer library, and below that we can see this is the method which I have used to return the shadow root elements so that the driver can take actions on it, and which I am using these elements right there. It's very basic code. I haven't improved it a lot, but just to show you the demo, guys. And here we can see after getting the shadow root elements, then we can append another elements and we can take actions on those. Let me execute it by using testng. So this is the same application which I have shown you guys. It's in the blue colored. Here we can see it will add some test plans on the right side. It will add two plans for today and two plans for later. I have applied some weight on these scripts so that you guys can see it. Okay, this is done and we can see it is passed. So the main thing is interaction with those Shadow DOM elements, and later we can just apply JavaScript executor and we can take actions. So this is the approach which we have taken by using WebDriver, and let me move ahead. Now it's time to take another approach. It's by using WebDriver IO. So WebDriver IO basically supports natively by using two different approaches. One is the shadow dollar. Here we can see it has two different inbuilt commands. One is shadow dollar, one is the shadow double dollar. Shadow dollar basically we use to access an element inside a given element's shadow root. It will fetch the element which is a single element. If there are multiple elements, kind of list of the elements, in that case we have to use shadow double dollar, and we can fetch those elements one by one by our regular approaches. So here we can see we are getting here. I have used JavaScript. I am just fetching one element by using shadow dollar. This is inside the shadow root, and again we have another shadow root element. It's enter text area. So there are multi-level shadow roots, and we are fetching those elements by using this shadow dollar. Let me open the code and let me show you the demo. Here we can see here we are fetching, we are returning those elements by using shadow dollar. And below that, we are just taking actions on those found elements. And finally, we are calling these methods inside the test script, which I have used there. Let me run this. So it will open the same application, then it will take the same actions, but this time it is by using JavaScript, and then WebDriver we have used Java. So it will add two test plans for today and then later. And it is passed, and we can see all of the actions has been taken and it is successfully executed. So now we have seen two different approaches. First is by using WebDriver. Second approach is by using WebDriver IO. So here I just want to suggest one thing to everyone. For example, if you guys, anyone of you guys using WebDriver already by using Java as a technology, and some of the pages the developer implements by using this, maybe any library, maybe HTML5 or maybe lit element library or maybe polymer library, and in that case you can take the first approach because you have no need to change your tool. In that case you can continue with your automation scripts by using the first approach. But if in case you know the JavaScript and you are starting your project automation from scratch, in that case you can go with the second approach, because WebDriver IO, it's giving native support for the shadow DOM. But I have seen the code, I have seen the code for WebDriver IO. Internally it is using the same thing which we are using with the Selenium WebDriver, because it has written some just wrapper method over the same thing. And internally it is using the same JavaScript and all. So here I have mentioned some references. You guys can go through these references, like about Shadow DOM. If anybody wants to know about the Shadow DOM, then can go through this link. If anybody wants to take a Shadow DOM approach with Selenium, then there are some methods which you guys can have dependencies by using pom.xml file. And here you guys can see the shadow DOM approach by WebDriver IO. So you will see these shadow dollar and the shadow double dollar methods. And below, I have, this is my GitHub account where you guys can see the test applications which I have shown you guys, and the Selenium approach and the WebDriver IO approach. So I'll make it public today so that you guys can get this and you can try at your end. So that's all about this session. If you guys have any questions or any doubts about it, and I hope I have cleared each and everything, but I am open for any kind of questions.
Thank you, Virinder, for that. I think the audience had a question regarding whether the code would be available. So I think you've answered that towards the end.
Yeah.
Okay, so we have quite some questions posted. So I'll take them one by one.
Okay.
So the maximum vote is for the question, what is the difference between light DOM and shadow DOM?
Okay, so light DOM, basically it's our the main DOM, which we usually see. Forget about shadow DOM first. Suppose I want to automate my application. The first of all, I always look at it. It's a light DOM, or we can say it's a main DOM. So the entry point for the main DOM, still it's a query. For shadow DOM, it's a part of the light DOM, we can say. But it renders separately. That's the reason we cannot interact with the shadow DOM elements. And another thing, it's like developers make the mode is closed. In that case, we cannot interact with any element at any cost. But if the developers make the mode is open, then only we can interact with those elements by using JavaScript. Shadow DOM, basically, it's a part of light DOM, we can say. It renders inside that light DOM.
Okay. We have another question again on the differences. What is the difference between shadow DOM and iframe?
Okay. Iframe, it's an older technology. Earlier, the developers using iframes, but nowadays they are not using iframes because there are some cross-site scripting issues. But now they have started using shadow DOM. It's a kind of iframe, but it is completely quarantined from the light DOM. This is what I can say now. It's kind of similar things, but it's completely quarantined. But iframe was not quarantined from the light DOM. So this is the only difference between iframe and the shadow DOM elements.
Okay. The next one is, what is the purpose of creating shadow DOM?
Okay. Purpose of the creating shadow DOM is that, suppose I am creating one of my plugin and I just want to sell these plugins to different vendors, or we can say different web applications. In that case, what will happen? This plugin won't interact with their HTML codes, and their code won't interact with this plugin code. Plugin HTML or the JSS, or we can say CSS. So they will render on the same browser, on the same DOM, but they won't interact with each other. They can work flawlessly with each other, but they won't hamper anything of each, and like they won't hamper each other's code. So that is the reason they are using shadow DOM nowadays. So this is kind of security issues, we can say. And second is they are not accessing each other's properties. So this is the main reason.
Okay. Another one, how to check if the shadow DOM element is closed?
Can you please come again, Shweta? I didn't get this question.
So how to check if the shadow DOM element is closed?
Okay, yeah. Even I have shown there, just a moment, yeah. Let me open it once again. If I make it closed, I have made it closed. And if I just refresh it, then we can see the shadow root, it's closed. We can clearly see right there. And in that case, if it is closed, then we cannot access this element. This is the simple thing which we can see by using the developer's tools.
Okay. We'll take a couple of more. Is that why and when do I think web developers use Shadow DOM? I think that is also answered broadly.
Yeah, I think it is already covered because there are two reasons.
Okay, how many ways we can find these Shadow DOM elements?
Here, I would say like JavaScript is the only scripting language which has complete access of the DOM. So JavaScript, we can use JavaScript and we can access those elements at any point of time, but we have to use Shadow Root API to fetch those elements. That's the only thing which we have to use. Otherwise, the JavaScript works well with it. Because simple selectors, strategies like XPath and CSS, they won't work at any cost. So it's a useless for Shadow DOM elements.
Okay. Then if Shadow DOM is closed, it means we cannot access with any workaround.
Yeah. In that case, we don't have any workaround to access those closed elements. So that's why I have explained earlier, if this is mandatory to make the elements closed mode, so in that case, we can talk to developers and we can ask them to make it open on the sandbox or the test environment, and they can make it closed for the production environments. This is the only solution, which we did in our company, in my project. Otherwise, there is no workaround to interact with the closed elements.
Okay. Thank you so much, Virinder, for answering those questions. It was a wonderful session. We already have a lot of good feedback coming in on the channel on Discuss.
Thank you so much, Shweta, and thank you so much, everyone, for joining this session. I hope I did not waste your time, and I hope you learned something new for your career.
The session was brought to you by Sauce Labs.